Welcome to the last video for a moment for numerical methods for eigenvalue problems. In this video, we will shortly discuss the QR algorithm for computing eigenvalues. And the QR algorithm is the standard way for dense matrices if you want to find all of the eigenvalues at once. It is quite cheap to find the eigenvalues, and it's a kind of continuation or smarter version of orthogonal iteration. So what we will see in this video are the following points. So we will first look at a short introduction, and then we will try and make the computation of the QR decomposition, that is a part of the algorithm, cheaper. And we do that by preparing our matrix. So we start with the general matrix, then we will bring it to a special form, which is upper triangular plus one extra lower diagonal. And then we will see that during the iteration, the QR can be quite cheap using Givens rotations. Furthermore, we will try to speed up the algorithm a little bit by introducing a shift like we did for the power method. So let's see. First, before I go here, this journal here, so Computing in Science and Engineering. At the year 2000, they picked the 10 algorithms with the greatest influence on the development and practice of science and engineering in the 20th century. So maybe you recognize a couple of algorithms from different branches of mathematics that you have studied in other courses. So maybe, for instance, you have seen the simplex methods, or maybe you heard about Kreilov subspace iteration methods for solving linear systems. The decomputational approach, that is kind of what we have been doing with LU factorization. And then in this video, I will talk about the QR algorithm for computing eigenvalues. So that's the main topic here. Then a sorting algorithm, quicksort. Maybe you heard about fast Fourier transform, and probably the other ones you haven't heard about before. But just wanting to point out how important this algorithm is, that is listed in this top 10 of major achievements of the 20th century. So let's see. The QR algorithm is the most widely used algorithm for computing the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of dense matrices. So dense means that most of the entries in your matrix are non-zero. If you have a matrix that has loads and loads of zeros in there, it's called a sparse matrix, and you have different methods. But if you have a dense matrix, QR is the default choice. And here is already a statement saying basically how cheap the algorithm is. So it allows to compute all the eigenvalues with a complexity that's comparable to solving a linear system. So if you recall, that's something like n to the power 3 when your matrix is n times n. So the orthogonal iteration that we looked at in a previous video is a component here. It uses shifts. And well, one of the main ideas here is that we first transform our matrix to a simpler form. So let's see how that goes. And what we use here is Givens rotations. And we looked at them in a previous video when we were trying to compute the QR decomposition. So let's see. The idea here is to transform our matrix into upper Hessenberg form. So upper Hessenberg forms upper triangular with one extra diagonal. So the idea is that before we start the whole QR iteration, what we do is we look at our general matrix. So here's a general 4x4 matrix, and the star means any non-zero entry. And what we do is we use Givens rotations, as will become clear, to transform it into a form where it's upper triangular. So that would be this form. And then there is one extra lower diagonal, and that's upper Hessenberg. And we can do that using Givens rotations. So just to recall, a Givens rotation is a rotation in a PQ plane. So if you look at the matrix that corresponds to it, it is the identity matrix mostly, except for rows P and Q and columns P and Q. And in those places, we have a C and a C on the main diagonal, and an S and a minus S on the corresponding columns rows. So here are the entries that are different from the identity matrix. And you can interpret this as a rotation in the PQ plane over an angle phi, where phi is such that c is the cosine of phi and s is the sine of phi. So we have c squared plus s squared equals 1, like cosine and sine. So what you can easily see if you compute g transpose g is that you find the identity. So it's an orthogonal matrix. All the columns have length 1. And if you take two different columns, they're perpendicular. And we have seen in a different video that you can use these Givens rotations to create a zero entry at one place in a matrix. So what we do is, if we start with, say, this 5x5 matrix, and in general all the entries will be non-zero, we are going to use a rotation in the 2-3 plane to create a zero in the first column. Since the length of the first column cannot change, we have to change another entry. So the other entry that we use is this below the diagonal. And why we do it like this will become clear in a second. But first we continue, and we also create a zero in the fourth row of the first column, and then in the fifth row of the first column. And like this, we go to upper Hessenberg form. So also the second column and fourth position, second column and fifth position. And we're almost done here, so now we need one more in the third column. We need to change in the 4-5 plane. So the conclusion after all these steps is that we have used all these rotations, Givens rotations, to get to a matrix H. So this is H here, which is an upper Hessenberg form. So we have left multiplied our matrix A with three Givens rotations to get the first column to have all the zeros there, below main diagonal, one lower diagonal, everything below that should be zero. And then there is two rotations that we need for the second column and only one rotation for the third column. Now, this is okay as it is, but there is an additional reason why I use the entries below the main diagonal to accomplish this, and that will become clear in a sec. So we can do this a little bit better, as it says here. So what we will do, so if we left multiply the matrix with G2-3, it changes rows 2 and 3. If we would right multiply with the transpose of that matrix, it changes only the columns 2 and 3. In particular, it means that if we create a zero using G2-3, that if I right multiply with this matrix, it doesn't spoil that. The zero is kept. So G2-3A has created a zero at this position here. And if I now right multiply with G2-3 transpose, it still has a zero at that position. So the same holds for all the other rotations. So what I can also do is not only multiply with all these G's, but I also right multiply with the transposes of them in the correct order. And the reason I do that is that I now have a similarity transformation. So in particular, the eigenvalues of this thing are the same as the eigenvalues of the A hat here. And that is a property that I like. So this A hat matrix has upper Hessenberg form, just like the H, because the zeros are still at the same positions. But also it is a similarity transformation, so it has the same eigenvalues as A. So this is a kind of preparation step, and the thinking behind it is that we transform our matrix into this upper Hessenberg form. And during the iteration, it is much cheaper to compute the QR decomposition of this upper Hessenberg matrix, because we only have to create zeros in this one extra lower subdiagonal. If I make zeros there, then I have upper triangular form and I found the QR decomposition. So that's the idea behind the algorithm here. So this is the start of the QR algorithm. And now we are going to work with A hat rather than A. So given a matrix, we do some preparation. This is the preparation phase. We only have to do this once. And now we are dealing with A hat. A hat has the same eigenvalues, but it has upper Hessenberg form. Now, we also need to pick a good starting matrix. So we start our iteration with some Q0 matrix, and this Q0 matrix should have directions basically in all the eigendirections, the direction of the eigenvectors. Now, what you can show, and I'll do that quickly because this is a kind of technical detail, I do not find that interesting. If a matrix is irreducible, so this is the main thing, if the upper Heisenberg matrix A hat that you want to work with is irreducible, then you can start the algorithm, the iteration, with the identity matrix. So that is the main message. And just as a kind of background, what was irreducible again? Well, a matrix is called reducible if you can find a permutation matrix, or permutation matrix just swapping rows around. And then if you do PAP transpose, that's swapping rows and columns, then you can get it in this form. So if you can get a permutation matrix such that you get a zero block, then it's called a reducible problem, because you can then split your problem into two smaller problems. You can do that in a problem involving A22 and first solve that. And once you have that solution, you can solve a new problem. You know all the variables related to this matrix, so you can solve a problem with A11, and then you have a smaller problem. So what we are going to assume is basically that we cannot break down our problem into smaller subproblems. We are going to assume that our matrix, the A hat, is irreducible. For a Heisenberg matrix, you can easily check whether it's reducible or not. If you have a zero on this subdiagonal, then it's reducible. So basically, the assumption we're going to make is that our matrix A hat does not have zeros on this subdiagonal, so the one diagonal below the main diagonal. And now the main idea is to do orthogonal iteration on the Heisenberg matrix. So we are going to start, we are going to assume that it's irreducible. So Q0 is the identity matrix. That is a good starting matrix. And then what we are going to do is compute A hat times QI, find its QR decomposition, QI plus 1 times RI plus 1, and then continue with QI plus 1. We are going to make it a bit smarter. So this is not the QR algorithm in its final stage yet, but this is the basic idea. So in every step, we have to do a QR decomposition, and that is cheap now because our matrix A hat here has this upper Heisenberg form. So here in this matrix, note that we take the full identity matrix, and these are all n times n. So we are computing all the eigenvalues of the matrix. Also, and this is a bit of playing around here, so what you see is this is the basic iteration. Now, if you pre-multiply this here with QI transpose, so I put a QI transpose here on the right, then I also have to put it on the left. And the reason I do that is because this here is again a similarity transformation. So that means that this A hat and what I call AI here have the same eigenvalues. This here is the product of two orthogonal matrices, which is again orthogonal, so I call that QI plus 1 with a tilde. By definition, or by construction, it's the product of two orthogonal matrices. Q tilde I plus 1 is orthogonal. And so we have that AI and A hat are similar. And something very funny is going to happen here. Watch this. So we have that Q tilde I plus 1 times RI plus 1, that's what it says here, that is defined to be AI. So that's what I'm going to start with. Q tilde times R is AI. Okay. Now, let us plug in the definition of Q tilde I plus 1. And also, I am going, if you compute RI plus 1 Q tilde I plus 1, so I swap the two factors, then I am going to plug in for RI plus 1 what we have here. So RI plus 1, let me write that down, makes it maybe a bit clearer. So from this here, what we have is that ri plus 1 itself is q I plus 1 transpose a hat qi. And if I now compute ri plus 1 q tilde I plus 1, you see that I find q I plus 1 transpose, so I plug in that. And here I have the definition of q tilde I plus 1, so that's here. So let's plug that in. So we have qi transpose qi plus 1. And what you see now is that here I have qi qi transpose. So that's the identity matrix, because qi is an orthogonal matrix. So what we find is that apparently this here is the same as qi plus 1 transpose, that's this one that's left, times a hat times qi plus 1. If you compare that to the definition of ai here, then you see that this is precisely ai plus 1. So apparently, what I need to do during the algorithm is that I compute a hat times qi, I find the qr decomposition, and then I swap the factors around to find ai plus 1. So let's write that down. So what we are going to do here is I am going to, well, first do the transformation to upper Hessenberg form. And that gives a hat, which we call a 0. Then I do a qr decomposition of ai, so a 0 in the first start, which gives me a q tilde times ri plus 1. And then I'm going to swap those two factors around, so this q tilde and this r, and that gives me the ai plus 1, and then I can repeat. So what you're doing all the time doing this qr algorithm is computing a qr decomposition and swapping the q and the r around. Now, all the ais you can easily verify are up in Hessenberg. So if you want to compute the qr decomposition, that's going to be cheap, because you only have to create n minus 1 zeros, the first diagonal below the main diagonal, and you only need n minus 1 Givens rotations to accomplish that. What you can also show, I'm not going to prove that here, is that the subdiagonal that behaves like a constant times lambda j over lambda j minus 1 to the power I. So they go to 0 if the eigenvalues are really different from each other. So what you see is that the ai's converge to upper triangular form, because the lower diagonal is going to 0. So let's look at an example. So the matrix that we have studied before has already upper Hessenberg forms, upper triangular with one lower diagonal. We have already seen the eigenvalues a couple of times. And now let's do this iteration here. So what we do is we compute the QR factorization, and then we swap the two factors around. So do R times Q. So here is A1, A2, and so on. And here is A34. I just looked at the iteration. I didn't do anything smart here. But you see that the eigenvalues appear here on the main diagonal. So indeed, this works, and this converges to the eigenvalues of the matrix A. For symmetric matrices, we've already seen that the power method works better for symmetric matrices. We have faster convergence there. What we have here for the QR method is that if you look at the upper Hessenberg form, well, all the zeros are copied from below also to above, so then we have a matrix that has only three diagonals. So what you see is that A hat for symmetric matrix is a tridiagonal matrix. And that's cheap to store and also cheap to do computations with, so that's nice. Finally, you can also speed up your QR method with a shift like we did in the power method. So what you can do is, well, transform A to upper Hessenberg form like we did before, and you get A hat, and that's what you use to start the iteration. And then what you can do is that you say, well, I'm going to do a QR decomposition of AI minus sigma I times the identity. So here is where we introduce a shift, and then we swap the factors and we add the shift again. Now, if you do that, you can show that during the iteration that AI plus one, so one iteration later, is what we had in the previous iteration times this number here. So you can get faster convergence here if you choose a shift sigma I, that is the best approximation you have to lambda n, because then this becomes very small. So summarizing, what we have seen in this video is that we can transform a matrix to upper Hessenberg form first to speed up QR decomposition, the computation of that. Then that we can use the identity matrix as a starting matrix for the iteration when A hat is irreducible. And we have seen the formulation of the QR algorithm to compute the eigenvalues, and we can use this to compute all of the eigenvalues. And basically what we do is we compute the QR decomposition and swap the factors, and we keep on repeating that until we have convergence. So I hope this gave a good impression of how the QR algorithm works. We didn't go into all the technical details, but I hope you have a good impression here. So that wraps it up for this video, and I hope to see you again in a next one.